start with WannaCry. What is the latest info you have on who's behind it and the actual extent of the damage?
Well, I think what we saw with WannaCry is a failure of the traditional legacy AV manufacturers, and we saw a large-scale infection. Who's behind it? I think there's a lot of researchers, including ourselves, trying to sort that out. I think it's still too early to tell. But when you look at the impact, I think it clearly highlights the need for technology that goes beyond what was done 30 years ago in pure signature-based endpoint technology designed to identify this. And that was one of the challenges that we've seen here, and that's why so many computers were actually infected.
There's been a lot of finger-pointing, Microsoft to the NSA, the government to companies like Microsoft. What do you make of the idea that, you know, Microsoft claims that the NSA should have been doing more to warn the private sector about zero-day vulnerabilities?
Well, you have to kind of separate these out. The governments who operate in the cyber battlefield are going to do what they do. They're going to look for vulnerabilities. They're going to look to exploit those, and that's just going to happen. I think what's most important is that companies and individuals need to make sure that they have the latest patches and certainly that they have the latest protection in place, things like artificial intelligence-driven endpoint technology that can actually identify these sort of attacks without actually having signatures created in advance.
Now, CrowdStrike, as I mentioned, is, you know, you guys are the ones that discovered Russian interference in the DNC. Have you seen any change in Russian cyber activity in the United States?
Well, whether it's Russia, whether it's any of the Middle Eastern countries, or whether it's e-crime, they're all formidable adversaries, and they continue to come up with new and innovative ways and techniques to try to get into companies, siphon data out. Data is a new weapon, so not only getting in, but being able to release and dump that data, and certainly use that data to extract more money. Enterprise-wide ransomware, WannaCry is a good example. So they just keep getting better and better as the good guys begin to tighten the noose and be able to identify them. So it's an ever-changing environment, and that's why people need to remain vigilant.
Okay, but what about Russia in particular? Do you see any connection between the cyber activity and the revelations that have been happening in Washington out of the White House?
Well, I think there's always a lot of activity, whether it's in the U.S. or whether it's outside. Obviously, Russia has incredible capabilities. And like most governments, they're going to look to leverage those capabilities across data exfiltration, intelligence gathering, you know, in some cases, perhaps leaking that data out on the internet for political purposes.
So where else might we see Russia being active this year? Any activity in Europe around the elections, for example?
Well, I think as was reported in the past, there was some reports about Russian activity in some of the elections. You know, and again, I think if you have a capable adversary, I think people need to be thinking about their own security, thinking about their own risk management policies, and making sure that they have the appropriate security controls and protection in place to identify not just malware, but the breach activity, which is most important. And again, I think that's where a lot of companies have fallen down, just trying to focus on the malware, not looking at the entire breach cycle.
Now, you said you're open to small acquisitions that might complement what you already do. What kinds of acquisitions might we expect, like threat detection technology, threat intelligence technology?
Well, I think since we have such a broad platform that looks a lot like Salesforce for endpoint security, anything that might tuck in and allow us to create a new application that rides on top of that platform, I think would be a good fit. We spent a lot of time to build the underpinnings and the technology itself, which has been very well received by our customers. So we want to continue on that path, and if we can add new capabilities, we'll continue to do that. We continue to look at acquihires. We spent a lot of time building our own artificial intelligence capabilities, and we look to add to those across the platform to provide even more robust prevention and detection capabilities for our customers.
And where are you expecting CrowdStrike to expand geographically?
Well, there's been a massive expansion already. I mean, just from our C round to our D round, we've added 400 people. We've expanded into Europe. We've gone from 4 offices to 15 offices. We've expanded into Asia Pacific, Australian office. We opened an office in South America. So we continue to fill that out, and we've just seen such a spike in demand that we want to make sure that we can service those customers that are locally. And security is a local sale. You have to be there, and you have to show up, and you have to make sure that you're looking at the local threats, being able to make sure that you have the right protection for those customers.